going to begin the 2017 Next Generation Conference. My name is Diana Chung, and I will be your MC for today. As an intern of the East Asian Institute, I am proud and excited to be here today with esteemed professors and the next generation of upcoming scholars for an invigorating discussion and debate on issues of current debate in Korea. Interpretation will be provided on Channel 1 for Korean and Channel 2 for English. Also, please be kind and courteous to the participants by silencing your mobile phones. Our conference today will be separated into three main sessions, each featuring a presentation followed by a discussion from each designated individual and a Q&A session. At the conclusion of the presentations, we will hold our award and certificate presentation. Now, without further ado, let me introduce to you Korea University's Professor Shin Jae-hyuk for today's opening address. Sorry. Please join me in welcoming him for a round of applause.
Thank you. 소개받은 신재혁입니다. 우선 이렇게 넥스트 제너레이션 컨퍼런스 오신 여러분들 다 환영하고요. 제가 오늘 오면서 카운트를 해봤어요. 2013년부터 이제 여기 이제 사회도 보고 뭐 이렇게 했거든요. 그러니까 벌써 이제 다섯 번째로 이제 논문 심사, 뭐 그다음에 사회 이런 걸 했는데. 굉장히 재밌습니다, 저는. 왜냐하면은, 외국 학생들이 한국에 대해서 어떻게 생각하나, 이제 이런 것도 이제 들을 수 있는 기회고, 그 다음에 이제 더 중요한 거는 한국에 이제 어느 살고 있으면서 어쩌면 이제 너무 익숙해가지고, 별로 궁금해하지 않았던 거를, 이거는, 굉장히 궁금한 거다. 이렇게 이제 얘기를 해주면은, 한국에 대해서도 이제 뭔가 좀 새로운, 사실도 알게 되고 또 이제 그런 이제 고민해보게 되는데, 과거에 이렇게 발표하셨던 분들 중에 재미있는 기억에 남는 이제 그런 것들이 몇 개 있는데 예를 들어서 이제 한국에 이제 살면서도 잘 몰랐던 뭔가 한국의 암울한 현실, 예를 들어서 뭐 자살률이 세계 1위라든지 아니면 노인 빈곤율이 세계 1위라든지 이런 얘기도 사실 여기 넥스트 제너레이션 컨퍼런스에서 과거에 이제 들을 수 있었고, 그다음에 오늘도 이제 발표문 중에 하나는 섹스 트래피킹에 대한 얘긴데 이것도 저는 이제 읽으면서 굉장히 깜짝 놀랐어요. 아니 진짜 이것도 세계에서 이렇게 높은 뭐 수준의 그런 국가인가 이런 것들도. 그리고 이제 한편으로 보면은 저기 뭐냐 외국인 분들이 나와서 이제 한국에 대해서 얘기를 하는 그 뭐 비정상 회담 그와 같은 이제 그런 TV 쇼랑도 이제 비교될 수도 있는데 제가 생각했을 때 요 넥스트 제너레이션 컨퍼런스는 비정상 회담보다 훨씬 더 재밌을 수 있는 게 그냥 요렇더라라는 것만 얘기한 게 아니라 그렇다면 그게 왜 그럴까를 이제 생각할 수 있다는 거. 뭐 예를 들어서 이제 과거에 발표했던 논문 중에 북한이 미사일을 쏘고 뭐 핵실험을 하고 그러면은 다들 외신부터 한국에 사는 외국인들은 굉장히 다 겁을 낸단 말이죠. 야 전쟁이 나면 어떡하지? 근데 좀 놀랍게도 주변의 한국 친구들은 아무 일도 아닌 것처럼 하나도 놀래지도 않고 겁내지도 않고. 그래서 그게 이제 신기한데 그 왜 그럴까? 뭐 이런 것들도 이제 다른 적도 있고 하여튼 그래서 오늘도 세 분의 이제 발표를 세 명의 이제 발표를 들으실 텐데 다 굉장히 재밌는 그런 주제들이고 또 이런 주제들에 대해서 왜 그럴까? 이런 것도 같이 생각해 볼 수 있는 좋은 기회가 될 수 있을 것 같습니다. 그래서 오늘 발표자분 그다음에 토론자분들 다시 후회 주시겠지만 여기 모신 청중 여러분들께서도 아주 적극적으로 참여를 많이 해주시면 감사하겠습니다. 네, 환영합니다. 다시 한번.
Thank you very much, Professor. Now we will have Lee Byung-gun, the first prize recipient of the 2017 Next Generation Conference, deliver our welcoming remarks. Please welcome him.
Next Generation Conference에 참여했던 중국의 유학생 이병준이라고 합니다. 진재혁 교수님 그리고 오늘 참여하신 여러분들 만나 뵙게 돼서 굉장히 반갑습니다. 그리고 이렇게 조용한 자리에 불러주셔서 영광스럽게 생각합니다. 작년 이맘때 제가 이 자리에 서서 발표를 했었는데 어느덧 1년이라는 시간이 지났습니다. 그때 저는 왜 전세 제도가 한국에서만 발달하는가라는 주제로 발표했었습니다. 감사하게도 최우수상을 받아 2016년 중 제일 기뻤던 하루이지 않았는가라는 생각을 하고 있습니다. 저는 이 프로그램에 참여하면서 제한테 많은 도움이 돼서 두 차례나 참여했습니다. 그리고 이 프로그램을 통해 한국의 정치, 경제, 그리고 문화, 문학 등 다양한 주제를 갖고 전문가들로부터 여러 가지 의미 있는 특강을 들었습니다. 이러한 과정을 통해 여러분들도 한국 사회에 보다 올바른 인식을 갖게 되었으리라 생각합니다. 한국 속담 중에 그런 말이 있습니다. 구슬이 서말이라도 꿰어야 법이다라는 말이 있습니다. 저희가 단순히 정보와 지식을 습득하는 그런 차원에 머무르는 것이 아니고 브레인스토밍의 과정을 통해서 오늘과 같이 이러한 자리를 통해서 서로 생각을 주고받고 하는 것이 굉장히 의미 있다고 저는 생각합니다. 저희가 비록 한국에 관련해서 배우고 있지만 어쩌면 그러한 문제는 한국만의 문제일 수도 있고 그리고 또한 시대적인 문제일 수도 있고 혹은 세계적인 문제일 수도 있다고 생각합니다. 예전에 어떤 분이 저한테 지식은 학교에서 배우고 지혜는 사회에서 배운다고 알려준 적이 있습니다. 지금 돌이켜보면 꼭 맞는 말은 아니지만 그래도 지식과 지혜를 겸비한 사람이 되어야겠다는 생각을 해봅니다. 한국에서 공부하고 유학하고 생활하면서 KVAI에 참여했던 그런 경험들이 추후에 꼭 고등한 추억이 될 것이라고 저는 확신합니다. 날씨도 추운데 발표 준비하느라고 많이 힘들었으리라 생각됩니다. 그만큼 오늘 보람있는 시간을 보냈으면 좋겠습니다. 다시 한번 환영하고 축하하고 그리고 감사드립니다.
감사합니다.
Now we will proceed to the presentation portion of today's conference. Our presentations today will be moderated by Professor Jae Hyun Shin.
네, 이제 사회적으로 변신해서 오늘 컨퍼런스를 이제 진행하겠습니다. 저기 먼저 그 발표자 세 분을 먼저 소개를 드리고 그다음에 뭐 주제에 대해서도 발표할 주제에 대해서도 간단히 이제 말씀드리고 그다음에 토론자분들 소개를 간단히 드리고 시작하겠습니다. 먼저 첫 번째 발표자는 미국 조지타운 대학교 외교학과를 다니고 계신 원 고혜사 씨입니다. 먼저 박수를 주시죠. 오늘까지 아까 말씀드렸던 이제 그 섹스 트래피킹에 대한 이제 논문을 발표해 주시겠고요. 그다음에 두 번째 발표자는 우즈베키스탄에서 오셨고 현재 인하대학교에서 국어 공부랑 전공하고 계시는 카리모바 니고라 씨. 네. 카리모바 니고라 씨는 이제 통일 문제에 대한 논문을 발표하실 겁니다. 왜 한국은 이렇게 북한하고 이렇게 통일하는 게 힘드냐? 독일을 동서독도 다 통일하고 뭐 다 했는데 그죠? 그런 문제를 이제 말씀해 주실 테고. 그다음에 마지막 발표자는 미국에서 오셨고 현재 한국학 중앙연구원에서 종교학을 공부하고 계시는 에릭 라인버거 씨. 에릭 씨는 유교하고 기독교 간의 관계에 대해 관심이 많으시대요. 그래서 제가 여쭤봤어요. 기독교하고 유교, 컨퓨셔니즘 관계가 있느냐? 있다 그럽니다. 그래서 일단 그 관계에 대해서도 좀 들어보실 텐데 하여튼 그 왜 한국인들의 뭔가 좀 특별한 뭐 유교적인 문화랄까? 이제 그런 것들은 이제 외국인이 살면서 느끼면서 이게 좀 쉽지 않다. 왜 그럴까? 하여튼 그런 문제를 이제 말씀해 주실 테고요. 그 다음에 각 발표자들의 발표가 있은 다음에는 지금 지정 토론자분들 여섯 분이 계신데 각 발표에 대해서 이제 두 분씩 토론해 주시겠습니다. 각 토론은 이제 첫 번째 원보이사 씨 논문에 대해서는 반주영 씨. 네, 반주영 씨. 반주영 씨는 지금 듀크리 학교에서 정치외교학을 공부하고 계십니다. 박수 한번. 그다음에 두 번째 토론자는 연세대학교에서 정치학을 전공하고 계시는 이학영 씨. 네, 박수 한번 부탁드립니다. 이하영 씨. 이하영 씨가 반주영 씨한테 첫 번째 논문 토론해 주실 테고, 그다음에 두 번째 저기 칼리모바 니고라 씨 논문에 대해서는 지금 고려대학교 정치외교학과에서 공부를 하고 있는 압둘라 빅자드 씨. 네. 그다음에 미국 존스 홉킨스 대학교에서 국제관계학과 학을 전공하고 계시는 줄 피터 씨. 네. 그다음에 세 번째 논문 에릭 씨의 종교와 유교에 관한 그런 논문에 대해서는 첫 번째 토론자는 스탠포드 대학교 국제관계학과 재학 중이신 쿡 싱클레어 씨. 두 번째 토론자는 존스 홉킨스 대학교에서 국제관계학 전공하고 계시는 노준수 씨. 먼저 발표는 시간상 15분 내로 맞춰주시고요. 그다음에 이제 15분 발표 끝나고 나면은 각 토론자분들께서는 7분 7 minutes 내로 해주시길 바랍니다. 그렇게 한 다음에 이제 청중 여러분들하고도 Q&A 세션도 좀 길게 가지면 좋으니까요. 네, 그러면 더 길게 해서 시간 쓰지 않고 바로 이제 발표를 듣도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 원보혜 씨 발표해 주십시오.
15 minutes about the relationship between culture, society, and the effect on the South Korean sex industry in terms of consumption and sex trafficking. So in order to pique your interest a bit, I'll open with a rather startling statistic that encouraged me to delve more deeply into this topic. So as you can see, over 50% of Korean men have paid for sex at least once in their life. And this is not just a one-off thing. Shockingly, the average number of sex purchases per person was over 8, so I thought I would present these statistics to sort of underscore the prevalence of sex consumption in South Korean society. And on an interesting note, 1 in 4 of the men who bought sex said they did so out of curiosity. So now I hope you too are driven by curiosity as to why the consumption of sex in South Korea might be so widespread. So let's do a brief introduction into the South Korean sex industry and sex trafficking to provide some context. So to begin with some basic numbers, a South Korean government organization, which conducts a survey every 3 years on the South Korean sex industry, reported in 2016 that there are over 1,800 establishments involved in prostitution across South Korea. And this is a very marginal increase from the last time they conducted the survey in 2013. But the number of sex workers in the country does appear to be declining. So in 2013, they reported about 5,100 sex workers, and now you can see there's around 4,400 in 2016. Additionally, the survey found that the sex workers worked on an average of 8 to 12 hours a day, making around $70, which is about 78,000 won. And the survey found that the health conditions of a majority of the surveyed sex workers were reportedly poor, and they were also predominantly in debt, which just goes to indicate the significant vulnerability of these types of workers. So we'll move on a bit and look at some recent changes. And a lot of these photos are actually supposed to be, you know, in red light districts in South Korea, so I'm trying to find some realistic things. These are some of the more substantial advancements in recent years. So before laws were passed in 2004 criminalizing the buying and selling of sex, the sex industry actually made up more than 4% of South Korea's GDP, coming in at around $22 billion. Now, the next thing I'll read actually made me laugh because I was so surprised when I was doing my research. But this $22 billion spent on prostitution was actually similar to the amount that the Korean government spent on education that year and half of what it spent on defense. And really, that amount was actually greater than the contribution of agriculture to South Korea's GDP. And I know South Korea is a small country without much land, but that really did shock me. So it just goes to show the extent and scale of the sex industry before the government crackdown in 2004. So in 2002, you can see that South Korea was given the ranking of a tier one country, and this is what the US State Department report on trafficking in persons designates to countries whose governments are showing active efforts to fight the trafficking issue. But that does not really mean that trafficking in South Korea is not a problem. And moreover, in 2017, South Korea was still identified as a source, transit, and destination country for men and women both involved in the forced trafficking for labor and sexual exploitation. So now I'm just going to briefly describe some of the different types of sex trafficking that you find in South Korea. So there's the forced prostitution of foreign female migrants, which employers can achieve by deceiving these migrants about the economic opportunities that they can find in South Korea. And then they actually withhold the passports from these migrants in order to ensure their compliance, and they might, you know, keep these women captive in one location. There's also the international marriages between South Korean men and foreign wives. And these wives can face violence from their husbands and their households upon arrival, or they can also be trafficked into forced labor conditions as well as sexual trafficking. And then the last one you see is debt bondage. And so forced bondage prostitution of Korean women occurs when women are forced into prostitution by traffickers who force them into paying off supposed debts that these women incurred when they were being transported, sometimes voluntarily, into the country. So all these different forms of trafficking in South Korea, I hope you can see that there's a degree of force, deceit, and coercion involved in sex trafficking. So in addition to those direct forms of sex trafficking that I just mentioned, South Korean men also play a very troubling role in facilitating sex trafficking abroad with a very vulnerable group. So as you can see here, Korean men are in fact the primary customers of child sex tourism in Southeast Asia and the Pacific Islands, which I found a pretty disturbing fact. So now that I've painted a very quick and broad picture of the sex industry, I feel I can now go into my research question, which is how can or how do cultural and social factors promote the consumption of sex and encourage sex trafficking in South Korea? So existing literature I'll just briefly mention sort of goes into large-scale push and pull factors in terms of human trafficking. So push factors are things like instability within a migrant's home country, poverty, such things. And then pull factors are kind of like the allure of a recipient country. So with South Korea, you see women from Southeast Asia migrating because there's poverty in their home country, which is the push factor. And then they are pulled to South Korea because of the higher wages, which they so they intend to send remittances back home to their families by trying to find work in South Korea. But that leaves them vulnerable to the exploitative situations that I sort of mentioned. So here are some of the factors that I thought might play a role in sex trafficking and sex consumption in the South Korean industry. So the first social factor or cultural factor is gender discrimination in South Korea. And I believe that this creates sort of unequal relationships of power and control structures. And ultimately what this leads to is a devaluation of women's worth and ability in both the eyes of the women who are trafficked, but also the traffickers. Two, there's also a normalization of violence. And I will show some statistics that go to sort of prove that there seems to be a widespread social acceptance of abuse and violence in South Korea. And lastly, and I believe that this contributes to sex trafficking and sex consumption. I believe that the traffickers, or the men in this case, have a sense of perceived superiority because of the gender discrimination that I mentioned. They also have a heightened ability to control women, and this sort of leads to, and there's also a social acceptance of the exploitation of women. So firstly, gender discrimination. I open with this quote, you know, the strong sex trade is prevalent of attitudes that are negative towards women, and it's a way to exploit and control women. I open with that quote because I want to stress that it's important to understand the presence of negative attitudes towards women in order to understand more deeply the motivating factors behind individuals in an industry which predominantly involves the use of control, domination, and exploitation of women. So you have men primarily who either consume sex and basically use these women for the satisfaction of their sexual desire, or you also have the traffickers who use women for self-profit and economic motives. And so in both of these areas, it's important to kind of recognize and examine the cultural norms and values which could encourage these exploitative practices. To understand gender discrimination within South Korea, it is necessary to first look into South Korea's Confucian heritage and the Confucian code of conduct, which supports a hierarchical system of relationships in which there are perceived subordinates who are expected to demonstrate these three things: obedience, loyalty, and respect to their superiors. So for instance, from wives to their husbands. So the patriarchal system established by Confucian heritage establishes one relationship that is established is between husband, or more generally, I argue, just as men who are the superiors to their wives, or more generally, women. And so the women, I argue, are reduced to the status of subordinates. And while I do recognize that the Confucian code of conduct does emphasize the importance and of a reciprocal relationship, which basically means that it should benefit both parties, it really ultimately is the superiors, men, who can bestow benevolence upon the subordinates, while subordinates must in turn grant their obedience and respect. So ultimately, I believe that the cultural values that are characteristic of the Confucian tradition really do perpetuate a structural system that is based in ideas of control over, domination of, and ultimately servitude by women for men. And so this is what I am describing when I say an imbalanced relationships or an imbalanced power structure. But you might ask, does this system of power and control as described by the Confucian tradition actually affect something like the sex industry and sex trafficking in a tangible manner? I do argue yes. So a 2009 criminal report conducted by the South Korean Institute of Criminology actually analyzed interviews, it conducted and analyzed interviews with several South Korean sex trafficking victims and associates in the trafficking trade. So associates are like owners or managers of sex establishments. And it described, quote, South Korea, for example, has a strong Confucian heritage, and our preliminary research has shown that female Koreans in trafficking situations generally are very hesitant to speak out against their traffickers. Many did not even identify themselves as victims of trafficking. So while the statement from the report is not conclusive in any certain way, I believe it has implications for the role of culture and its effect on the interaction between gender and the power dynamic that I think you can find in the sex industry. And it also suggests that the Confucian heritage in South Korean society can promote an imbalanced power structure which encourages submissiveness and passivity from female sex trafficking victims in exploitative situations. And I believe and argue that this has the effect of removing a sense of agency from female sex workers and provides traffickers and consumers with a more exploitable pool of labor. I'll go into this in a little bit. But so the implications with the whole idea of Confucian heritage and power dynamics, I'm not only seeing that this makes the job easier for South Korean sex traffickers, but that the same norms which cause female sex workers to act more submissively can also encourage sex consumers or traffickers to feel it is their right to control the women in these situations due to their own perceived superiority as men in the system. And not all traffickers are men, but for the sake of my research, I just sort of focused on that. And the societal system of establishing men in positions of naturally accepted authority in conjunction with the submissive behavior from female sex workers who comply with being used for sexual satisfaction and profit may serve to solidify the sense of relative power of the so-called superiors in this relationship. So now this raises the question, why is this really important in terms of longer-term gender equality in South Korea? Well, as you can see, given that South Korea ranks a very dismal 116th out of 144 countries in the world global gender gap, I believe that the relationship between the perception of women as belonging to a lower status and also the relationship between that and the behaviors which can enable individuals in the sex industry deserves greater attention. Because one report sort of described that this wage gap is an indicator not just of inequality, but it reflects the belief that women are still categorically inferior in the eyes of men. And others also argue that the inequality between men and women in South Korea is reproduced through the buying of sex, and that they argue that buying sex essentially has to do with power. So given these statements, I think it's clearly important to understand how the perpetuation of these unequal relationships in the South Korean sex industry can ultimately have an effect of perpetuating traditional gender roles in society. So second cultural factor is the normalization of violence against women. And I open with this rather troubling traditional Korean adage, which describes a dry bullock and a wife must be beaten once every 3 days. So I quote that to present just a worrying example of the historic acceptance and encouragement of partner abuse and the subjugation of South Korean women to violence, which, as you will see by these next statistics, is still widespread today. So in a 2015 survey conducted by the Ministry of Gender Equality and Family, it showed that domestic violence occurs in over 40% of all South Korean households. You can also see that over almost 90% of the victims of violent crime in South Korea were women, even in 2015. And the third, I was actually also shocked to learn that Korea was among the top three places with the highest female homicide victim rate in the world. It recorded a staggering 52.5% in comparison to 12% in the Philippines and 21.9% in China. So I'll let that sink in because I guess I'm very surprised. So in my paper, I quote a worker at the Korean Sexual Violence Relief Center who described that she believes such violence occurs because Koreans consider their wives as personal belongings. And then this worker cited examples in which women would call the police in instances of domestic abuse and then actually be discounted by the police, who would instead listen to the husband's opinion before then dismissing the situation and just returning back. So the South Korean authorities' dismissal of household violence, I believe, is just one example indicating the normalization of violence in South Korean society and the lack of social stigmatization concerning the use of force and violence in relationships. And I believe that, so the second point you see, victim-blaming culture, I believe, is an interaction between the first cultural factor, which I mentioned, which is gender discrimination, and the second, which is a normalization of violence. And what that produces is a very harmful victim-blaming culture in which, you know, you see over half of South Korean men in a survey believe that sexual violence can be reduced just if women are careful. The second one, so apparently excessively revealing clothes is, you know, an adequate cause for sexual violence. And so these are just an indication of that victim-blaming culture. I describe the normalization of violence and both within the household and just in general towards women in society because reports have suggested that traffickers are supported by a broad societal culture of abuse, exploitation, and unhealthy relationships. And other studies have shown that the expectations of behavior within a cultural or social group can have the effect of encouraging violence. And so placing blame on victims for sexual violence and not on perpetrators, I believe has sort of a similar effect of just giving these men kind of like a get out of jail free card or sort of a moral pass to engage in exploitative sexual behavior and the subjection of women to abusive practices by sort of acting as though society condones these acts of violence against women. So in essence, I believe that in addition to this victim-blaming culture, the sheer prevalence of violence against women, which you could see in this slide, suggests that there's a normalization of abusive behaviors in households and in society in general. And I think that this means that South Korea just has a lowered expectation of what could be considered appropriate or inappropriate in treatment of women. And as some sources describe, the cultural acceptance of violence is a risk factor for all types of interpersonal violence. So I believe that South Korea's social tolerance of violent behavior in households, or more generally just towards women, may have the effect of setting a certain standard of behavior towards women that tacitly condones violence, which I argue may have the broader effect of destigmatizing the use of force in the trafficking industry. So I believe that we have to examine entrenched violence and victim-blaming culture in South Korea as a factor in encouraging the exploitative behavior in the trafficking industry. And as for a conclusion, rather than a traditional conclusion, since we'll be spending the next few minutes on all of our thoughts on the subject, I just wanted to talk about what additional questions I'm left with after concluding my research. One that I'm really excited to hopefully be able to spend time on is, how does military service socialize South Korean men and alter their perceptions of sex and the purchase of sex, given that some of these men are said to have sex for the first time with a prostitute during their military service? Another question is, what are the other various country-specific risk factors which make South Korean traffickers more vulnerable to engage in the trafficking industry, such as high youth unemployment? So these are some of the questions, and I'll leave you just with some of these headlines. As you can see, it's a very interesting topic, and there's a lot of recent literature and news articles on it. So if anything, elderly prostitution as a suggestion of elderly poverty, you see that there was the South Korean ban on prostitution was upheld in court recently, despite some protests actually from sex workers. And I'll conclude with that because, although I do talk about sort of the exploitation of women in this industry, I believe that you can also see indications in which these women do have agency and, in certain cases, see this as their livelihood. So it's a complicated situation, and I really thank you for listening during the over 15 minutes I had. So thank you very much.
이 발표에 대해서 저기 두 분의 토론자 아까 말씀드렸던 계신데 저기 먼저 반주영 씨 먼저 한 7분까지
Last year I remember that there are a lot of cases that sex industrial workers accuse their customers for rape. My first reaction was that this can't be a case. I was skeptical. And then right after that, I was surprised by myself, a future law school student, even have a bias against sexual industry workers based on their professions. And recalling this memory, I'm glad that this one has touched off on the relationship between the prevailing violence in sex industries and the broader societal and cultural factors which induces the victim blaming culture and the justification of domestic violence or dating violence. However, I believe that sometimes generalization of one group's characteristic based on culture or society can sometimes take our attention away from broader, larger, more important factors. In this case, there was the author puts that Confucian code of conduct makes the sexual industry workers submissive and passive and powerless in fighting against their managers, customers. And on the other hand, this also makes the customers to feel right to control women or exploit this woman. But it may be true, but as a person who's currently working in a pro bono law firm and who are dealing with a lot of cases of human trafficking, including migrant workers and with E6 visa, I do believe that there are countless victims who are trying their best to fight back their managers, their customers, their traffickers. But then, they are seems to be powerless right at this moment, and the questions should be restated as like why even though they do have a willingness, why do they stay powerless right now? And there are some more factors that I want to mention, and I hope that Ms. Won had mentioned in her paper. These are money, violence, visa problem, and lastly lack of legal protection or lack of the rigor of legal enforcement. And I'll first talk about the money. That these money or in other sense structurally indebted kept these women keep silent and like more powerless. For example, when the human trafficker sell these women to managers and the managers told these victims that we spent a certain amount of money to buy you and that you need to pay back, that's the only way to get out of here. And then once they started working, they the manager started to charge the cost of clothing, foods and lodgings, and this is a structurally indebted, and they forced to work in a continuously indebted status. And second, the violence. Many interviewees in our law firms told that their managers or traffickers had a sort of relationship between non-violence groups or so-called chulpok in Korea, and then once they run away, they're gonna chase by these people, and once they caught, they're gonna be more tortured or in, they're gonna be in a worse situations. And in this sense, we have to look at that Korean government does not have proper way to protect these people. We do not provide any legal protections once they, even though they are, even though the police department identify these victims as human trafficking victims. And the third thing is the visa problems. It's especially important for migrant workers. These days we're having a lot of Thailand or Philippines people coming coming to Korea and then with E6 visa, with our dream of becoming singers or other entertainment people with a dream of Korean wave. And these people are often become the victims of human trafficking into the sexual industry. But these people, once they become illegal or once they found violations of visa regulations, these visa problems can become a tool to direct these people. Because even though they are identified as human trafficking victims, Korean government or ICE officers often take these people, detain these people, and deport it. That's the only way to deal with these people. And under these legal systems, they do not have an effective way to fight back with the threats to be deported, threats to be beaten, threats to be paid back to a lot of money, like insane amount of money. And these sort of, all the three elements combined into the last factor, which is like lack of legal protection or lack of rigor in legal enforcement. And Korean government often stated that without kind of like sort of proud that they do have a lot of legal protections, and the indicator is that they recognize a lot of international treaties or other promises that protect the human trafficking victims or recognize the victims as a human rights violation of victims. But these enforcement, to make it these international treaties embraced in domestic sphere, they do revise the criminal codes. But then in reality, these criminal codes has never been enforced in any real cases. And those who were punished by human trafficking were people that can be punished without the charges of human trafficking. So there's no real concrete cases who were punished only by the human trafficking charges and with the revised criminal codes. And under these elements and then these legal systems, they are forced to become powerless, forced to become submissive, forced to become passive. And I just wanted to note that it's not that they are passive, they are submissive due to the cultures, but they're forced to do that. And there are a lot of reasons that I just need to, as a pro bono law firm, I just need to draw the attention to these factors, which is like broader, and then the things that we have to solve in the coming days. Thank you.
다음 바로 이하영 씨 코멘트도 부탁합니다.
Thank you for the great presentation. As I am reading this paper and then listening to the presentation, I cannot avoid feeling kind of shamefulness as a Korean man. And the statistics that you have shown was very staggering. But I do have some questions, although I'm not familiar with this topic. So, first of all, this paper deals with sex trafficking in South Korea, which is a very serious social issue, but relatively has less attention so far. And I think the questions and argument that you proposed on this paper are very important and timely. The last Saturday near the number 10 exit of Gangnam Station was a gathering of some female to protest against the hate toward women that is prevalent in the Korean society. And a year ago, a man killed a woman without reason. And some days ago, again, a similar thing happened. One man watched a personal broadcast about a woman working alone in a beauty shop, and he realized that she worked alone till late night and then went there and killed her. And so this sparked the large gathering of female people on the last Saturday. And then they were protesting because there is a very prevalent social atmosphere toward women, which you mentioned negative feeling toward the women. And I think it's very, very serious issue, and then it needs to have more attention from people. So they call the Korean society is not safe for women. And then I think this paper tries to explain what is the social and cultural factor that lead to this kind of phenomena. So the paper examines this with the concept of normalization of violence against women in male-female relationship in South Korea. I basically agree with the Bohesawan's analysis, but I wonder whether this is an independent variable or a dependent variable. You pick it as an independent variable in the your essay, but is it also one of the effects caused by social and cultural factors demeaning the values of women in South Korea? It can be an independent variable, but I feel like it's more like an independent variable. So so that's my first question. And then if that's the if that's the dependent variable rather than independent variable, then we have to ask why using violence against women is normalized in South Korea. And I think this has something to do with your first independent variable, gender discrimination. And then why South Korea has kind of social perceptions and gender discrimination. Your answer was Confucian heritage, right? And then I have 2 points here. First, to verify the paper's argument that the Confucian values were social and cultural roots of gender discrimination for both perception and system in South Korea, it should be first addressed whether South Korean society can still be categorized as a Confucian society. And from the first insight, the South Korea is one of the exemplary Confucian societies, but I think you need to prove it with more data, as you have shown with the data about sex trafficking and so on. So also, it will be more persuasive what kind of specific Confucian heritage is related to discriminated perceptions on sex and gender. You mentioned some of it in your presentation, but like not only South Korea, but also other societies have some kind of like patriarchal values. Then why a certain Confucian value can cause a sex or gender discrimination in South Korea should be addressed, I think. Second, the Confucian heritage is not a unique trait of the South Korean society. China, Taiwan, Vietnam, Japan, perhaps North Korea, and so on, all have inherited some Confucian legacies, then it should be addressed why, particularly in the South Korea, then can Confucian heritage be a causal factor to gender discrimination and to sex trafficking? What is the difference between South Korea and the others? So if the other Asian societies with some degree of the Confucian heritage also have distorted perceptions on sex, is it reasonable to define the Confucian heritage as a social and cultural factor of sex trafficking in South Korea? So I think this paper needs to have more comparative approaches than if you want to explain sex trafficking and sex industry in Korea with the independent variables such as culture and social factors, because it is persuasive when you argue with the unique traits of Korean society has worked as a cause of the problem. So these are the basic questions that I had while and after reading the paper. And after all, I think this paper is really important and raises very fundamental questions regarding sex trafficking in South Korea. As the first debater mentioned, I think money factor is very important. But besides that, we also need to look at the more broader and comprehensive factors that can explain sex trafficking and sex industry in South Korea. And that this can be probably found in the social and cultural cultural factors. Thank you.
네, 감사합니다. 자, 그 보혜사 씨가 먼저 두 분의 커멘트에 대해서 뭐 퀘스천에 대해서 간단하게 답변을 해주세요.
Wow, so many hard questions. I don't know if I can respond adequately. I think I agree with pretty much every single one of your points. I think what my research paper does is only just hypothesize about a very small, some people could argue even insignificant factor in light of the large, like what I earlier mentioned in my presentation are those large scale push and pull factors. I feel like, I don't know how I could quantify that, but it would make up a majority of the sort of cause of sex trafficking. And what you said with the idea of money, like that is a crucial part of the push and pull migration process, because these women are coming from developing countries in the hopes of securing an income to send back to their households. So I do agree with the idea of having to look at larger scale processes. In terms of the idea of the lack of legal protection towards women, I think it's a very important point, because you're right, they are trapped in these situations where they hesitate to go to law enforcement because they're afraid of being deported, which is a very realistic fear. I actually wrote a different paper for a class, and I talked about why I think that South Korean government might not recognize or want to recognize these women and provide them with legal protection. And I think they prefer for these women to stay underground in these underground economies and provide greater income for South Korean government without the government having to recognize these women as, you know, citizens or provide them with rights. And you can make a different comment on that. I totally understand. So I think it's better for the South Korean government in terms of a sort of state resource protection approach to not recognize these women as legal migrants and such. And I would be interested in also knowing if there's anything to do with sort of social discrimination, racial discrimination also affecting that decision on the part of the government. But thank you very much for your points. I'd love to look more into the legal protection. I think you made a very good point that that these are the sort of factors that are used as a threat to silence women, and not necessarily that they don't have agency because of themselves sort of as individuals, but because these larger factors are restricting them. I think that's a very good point. Thank you. Oh, so many points. I'm not sure where to even begin. I think I actually really did appreciate, at first you mentioned the Gangnam subway station protests, and interesting, I did read an article about how men protested that, men protested the protests of the women because it was sort of a very conservative group, and this group of men argued that you cannot judge, I think you mentioned similar things, you cannot judge all men in South Korean society based on the acts of one individual. And I understand that argument, but it was also interesting that they were upset that these women were complaining about rights when they did not have to to serve in military service. And so I think everybody should pay attention to sort of protests and protests against protests. So I just wanted to make that note. In terms of normalization of violence as a potential dependent variable, I do agree. It could be certainly, I think you're right. I think if I had to rewrite the paper, I would characterize it as a dependent variable, because I think that it's a symptom of larger structural processes. Because I don't think that people just suddenly say, I'm going to act violent towards someone, and that is the independent variable that leads to X, Y, Z, but I agree it's probably a symptom of other structural factors. And I think it could be tied to the idea of power and gender. There's an article about masculinized violence, and it talks about how men in these positions of power are not only able to be sort of the protectors of weaker victims, but also the ones who have the right to exploit that power. And this was actually in an article that talked about how there was the widespread sexual abuse of handicapped or disabled victims at, I think, either an elementary school or middle school. So I think you're right in the point that it's more of a dependent variable. And I wish I had a longer, bigger word limit so I could try to bring in some of the comparative analysis, because I also wonder, China is a Confucian state, like what about the sex trafficking there? And I have not really analyzed it yet, so I can't answer up on that, but I think that's also a good point. And a reason why, a possible reason why South Korea might show these tendencies more is because South Korea did have this rapid economic liberalization, and I will just make kind of an analogy. Like, there was this period where South Korea was going through a crisis because there was a bridge collapse, and then I think also maybe a department store collapse, and it was sort of, and also there was a scientist in South Korea who was found to be faking his research, and so it all suggested to South Koreans at the time that they had liberalized or grown too quickly economically, and they felt there was sort of like a national crisis. And so I wonder if there is a tie between sort of rapid economic liberalization and the like lagging sort of human rights recognition or lagging sort of perceptions of it's difficult. But I wonder if there's a tie. So that would just be one potential hypothesis of mine. And I think there's more points, but they were very good points, so I don't think I could address them so quickly. But yeah, thank you. Sorry.
네, 감사합니다. 이제 오래 기다리셨습니다. 이제 청중 여러분들이 자유롭게 어떤 질문이나 뭐 코멘트 등 좋습니다. 말씀해 주세요. 여기 한번 빨랐습니다. 먼저 하시고 두 번째.
topic, and as a Dutch person, I have a very different perspective than most in prostitution. And I was wondering if you're aware of the Nordic model, that is, it decriminalizes all those who are prostituted, so it gives them more rights, and it makes buying people for sex illegal. Do you think this Nordic model will work in the Korean society?
I do hesitate on saying that decriminalization is the way to go. I believe it's important to try to make every effort to protect these women and make sure that they can come forward to law enforcement officials, which is a major reason in why a lot of scholars think that these prostitution figures are underestimated, because so many women do not want to come forward. But I did see a paper on different European countries who had pursued decriminalization of prostitution as a whole. I don't think it was just of the sex workers themselves. And it showed that it actually had the effect of increasing the amount of human trafficking in those countries, which I only saw that one paper. It was very well cited. Other people had cited it. It was like 194 citations on it. But it did make, I think the argument was that by decriminalizing it, you have an increase in the available supply of sex workers. And what that does is, I guess it drives demand, so I think there's just a greater pool to be exploited. So I'm very interested, though, because I think this was the entire decriminalization, but it'd be very interesting to see if only decriminalizing these sex workers and not the buyers of the sex would have that similar effect. But thank you for the question.
And hello. Thank you for your presentation. My name is Ayuri. I'm from Russia. And I would like to, mine would be more as a suggestion than a question. I'm familiar with this topic, like, because from the web it was very like big issue on the internet, and they also mentioned about the working culture in Korea, how it is, how the superior person would say that let's have a drink and then let's go for the second round, the third round, and then the fourth round would be the sex trade place. So and I think those people who are participating in this trade transaction would not actually willing to do themselves, but they are forced to do that culturally. I think this is like also a big big point of the reason why people do that.
Thank you very much for that point. I did see some points made in articles about that. They were talking about, in the surveys that I mentioned, they talked about how, yes, social occasions were sort of a significant factor in why these people would choose to consume sex, essentially. And so they would be, the sort of factors were like after a night of drinking with friends, another one was before military service. And so there is definitely a big tie with sort of the social norm regarding it. That's why I'm also interested in studying the military and the role of prostitution in there, because it seems like it's sort of a bonding moment for South Korean men. And there was another article about, sorry, what was that? Oh, right, because they suggested that it's a way in business to do that because it's sort of like sharing a dirty secret with your business coworker, which makes you more willing to trust that individual. So it's very, very funny stuff. Yeah, interesting. But thank you for that.
And I think those people, they like not like not those people who serve in the army, like more are like more older people, like workers, because they actually have money to consume. And I don't think that the army people, they have as much money to go there often.
Right.
Yeah, so I think it's like you need to more concentrate on the workers.
Yes.
Yeah.
I agree, but I believe the survey showed that 53.8% of men who bought sex for the first time did so between the ages of 20 to 24. So I think they do have their first exposure, but you might be right. The continued use of prostitution might occur later in their career, which is a good point.
네, 또 다른 퀘스천이나 커멘트 없나요?
그러니까 저 혹시 한국어로 질문드려도 괜찮을지 제가 그
잠시만요.
I can maybe understand, but I want to hear understand.
그 강연을 들으면서 그 한국에서의 성매매 산업에 대해서 그 산업이 그렇게 발전한 데에 대해서에 대한 그 굉장히 뭐 reasonable한 이유를 되게 많이 들어주셔서 저는 그 이유들을 들으면서 특히 유교 문화를 한 가지 이유로 꼽은 데에 대해서 좀 감명을 받았는데요. 그 유교 문화가 하나의 이유가 된다는 걸 들으면서 저는 그 혹시 제가 생각하기에는 그 뭐 생명의 산업에 있어서 여성이 어떻게 그 포주에게 대들지 못하거나 하는 것이 유교 문화의 영향이 있는 한편으로는 혹시 그 일제강점기를 겪었기 때문에 어떤 일본의 영향도 크게 받지 않았나 하는 생각을 했는데 그 이후로는 일본 역시도 제가 그 데이터를 찾아본 데이터를 지금 다만 찾아볼 수는 없는데 한번 기사를 본 적이 있었어요. 그 일본 역시도 여권이 굉장히 낮은 나라로 제가 알고 있고 또 일본 역시도 성매매 산업이 좀 발전했다고 알고 있는데 예컨대 뭐 그 직접적인 성산업은 아니지만 유사적인 그런 것들도 많이 발전했다고 봤는데 혹시 그래서 이 그것에 대해서 연구를 하실 때 그 일본 문화로부터 비롯해서 그 한국의 성산업이 이렇게 발전한 데 그런 자료가 혹시 없는지 잘 궁금해서 여쭙게 되었습니다.
Thank you. There's definitely, I agree, a link between sort of occupation and wartime events. So basically in 1940s, there was over a million South Korean women who were working as prostitutes. This was after World War II, and this mainly happened in the U.S. Army camps and the bases that formed. But I have also read a kind of related article about how South Korean men's involvement in the Vietnam War, actually, they gained this sort of mindset about wanting to also take advantage or to conquer women. And so I think you're right in the idea of occupation and war and sort of the formation of a masculinized identity surrounded by conquering and that extends to the conquering of women. I did not delve very deeply into sort of the comfort women issue because I thought it had been a bit overdone, but I think there's definitely things to be said with that. But you are right in that, you know, around the war time that there's a big correlation. So yeah, because there was a million sex workers, I believe, in the 1940s because of war base camps. But I don't know how many of that is because of US Army base camps and then what role the Japanese had in that. So yes, but I will look into that. Thank you.
네, 감사합니다. 더 궁금한 게 있으시도 있겠지만 우리 또 발표자 두 명이나 더 남았고 그다음에 우리 또 점심도 먹어야 되니까 그죠? 네, 따라서 이제 이 정도로 첫 번째 발표 세션 마치고요. 바로 이제 두 번째 카리모바 교수님과 니고라 씨 발표 듣겠습니다.
서로 다른 이념을 하나의 대체와 이념으로 동합하는 새로운 건설을 만들어야 할 것입니다. 두 국가의 교육 사상과 교육 목적의 불협화 때문이죠. 한국에는 교육의 원리는 민주주의가 보장해주는 개인의 능력 개발인 반면에 북한 교육이 중요시 여기는 것은 독재를 숭배하지 않은 교육, 공산주의 이론과 양상입니다. 김일성, 김정일 우상화, 혁명 역사 다위가 기술이나 어학 과목들보다도 성적이 더 중요한 과목들입니다. 그리고 초등학교부터 고등학교까지 각각 꼭 가입해야 하는 군사화 조직체들이 있다고 들었습니다. 이에 따라 북한 학교가 키우는 인재는 사회주의 교육학의 기본 원리인 혁명과 노동계급화, 공산주의 사상들을 지키는 오직 사회를 위해서 사는 인재입니다. 세 번째 문제는 동일 이후에 생길 문제라고 생각하는데요. 바로 일자리 문제입니다. 북한 주민들은 노동력질이 낮고 시설 이용, 경영, 기타 기술 교육이 모자라서 취업이 어렵고 나라의 빈곤층이 될 가능성이 높으므로 국민의 빈부격차가 증가할 수 있다고 생각합니다. 높은 수준의 교육과 능력을 갖춘 남한 국민들과 경쟁하기가 어려울 것 같습니다. 경제 동일부에서 북한 주민들을 위한 교육과 취업 지원 제도가 잘 이루어져 있지만 탈북자 취업률은 여전히 낮고 탈북자들의 상당한 수가 정착의 어려움을 겪고 있습니다. 올해 6월 기준의 입국 인원은 합계 3만 명을 넘었는데 동일 후에는 취업 지원은 훨씬 치료될 수 있고 더 특별한 프로그램 기회를 필요할 것 같습니다. 네, 요약을 해서 저희 정책 지원에 대해서 말씀드리도록 하겠습니다. 네, 굳이 동일을 해야 하나라고 생각하는 한국 국민의 시선을 돌려야 합니다. 동일이 이루어지면 국가가 금속에만을 보겠다는 걱정 대신으로 국가 차원이 넓어짐으로 인해 생길 수 있는 경제적인 이익을 설명해야 합니다. 독일이 동일했을 때 엄청난 비용이 들었습니다. 그래서 남북 통일을 위한 자금도 미리 모아야 할 겁니다. 동일 이후 북한 주민이 한국 생활에 적응하기에 도와야 할 것입니다. 한국인 일상생활에서 필수적인 시설을 이용하는 방법부터 경영, 공학, 기술, 사업 등 영역의 교육을 이뤄야 할 것입니다. 그래야 북한 주민들도 취업을 얻고 좋은 인재가 될 수 있을 것입니다. 경제적인 이유로 위기를 겪어왔던 동일 독일의 사례를 보면 정부의 올바른 해결책과 국민의 단결로 분단이 되어있던 나라가 세계적으로 제일 선구적인 국가 중 하나가 될 수 있음을 명제해줘야 합니다. 한반도는 미국, 중국, 일본, 러시아 같은 주변 국가들과의 지지의 협력을 맺는 일도 중요합니다. 동일은 민족의 문제일 뿐만 아니라 국제적인 문제이기도 하기 때문입니다. 독일 동일은 단순히 동소득 사이의 교류의 증대로 이루어진 것이 아닙니다. 소득의 지원에 따른 동독의 변화, 그리고 제2차 세계대전 이후 독일을 분당하게 만들었던 소련, 미국, 프랑스, 영국 국가들 서로만의 동일의 부리가 됐다고 생각합니다. 소련이 동유럽을 포기했다는 점, 소득의 발전된 경제와 소득사회가 안정되어 있었다는 점, 소득 정부가 일치된 정책을 세운 것 등은 독일 동일을 이루어지게 했던 요인이라고 볼 수 있습니다. 예. 독일이 동일에 들어간 비용은 1조 5천억 달러, 5천억 유로로 계산됩니다. 지금도 동쪽 독일의 경제를 회복하기 위해 매년 1천억 유로 이상의 돈이 들어간다고 하는데요. 저음 동일 됐을 때 경제 격차가 상당한 정도였지만 동일 이후에는 많은 발전이 있었고 오늘날의 격차가 과거에 비해 심하지 않은 상태에 들어갔습니다. 예. 위의 문제들을 극복하기 위해 필요한 것은 또 교육 제공과 일자리 제공, 남한 국민의 자물성과 관심, 그리고 대비를 위한 시간입니다. 명화로운 동일을 위해서는 시간이 제일 중요하기 때문입니다. 성공적인 동일을 위해 정부의 정책뿐만 아니라 남한 국민의 의견을 들어주는 것도 아주 중요하다고 생각합니다. 예. 마지막으로 동일은 한국 민족에게 위기의 기회입니다. 충분한 예산과 준비가 있다면 비록 많은 어려움이 있다 할지라도 동일은 한 민족이 존엄과 번영을 이루는 데 결정적인 기회가 될 것입니다. 그러한 노력을 남과 북이 함께 해나가길 기대하며 발표를 마치도록 하겠습니다. 감사합니다.
네, 수고했습니다. 자, 통일을 왜 안 되냐. 먼저 압둘라 빅자르 씨, 네, 고민해 주세요.
Okay, thank you so much for your presentation. You have mentioned very important issues regarding the Southern North Korea. But of course, as you said, it's not an easy issue. There have been so much attempts since the separation of the two Korea. Unify this country where they have the same language, they have the same people, they have the same story, which whether it's sad or happy, they are. So I would like also to add some points on the issues that you have mentioned. But for me, I think that the regime difference between South and North Korea is much more important than the difference of education, than the difference of the job opportunities. You mostly mentioned about what will happen after unification, like how the South and North Korea are going to handle the situation after unification. But I think the fundamental question in this issue is how we can unify it first, and then we should think about that issue. So unification is difficult for South Korea to unify with North Korea because of the reason that we have a very different system in the North. In the North Korea, we have a leader who is very, in terms of military, very strong. And if the leader of the North Korea, I think if they are in terms of military less powerful, there would be less chance of, there would be more chance to reunify with South Korea. So they can stand against South Korea, they can stand against the other players in the region, like with Japan and with the United States. The separation of the two countries happened not only, it wasn't just an internal issue, there was many other players. So therefore, the unification of other countries needs the role of the other countries, mostly the United States, the Japan, the Russia, and the China. Another point is that we have Kim Jong-un, the leader of the North Korea. I think it's very important. I do not think that Kim Jong-un is going to give up the power. He might, so he wants to stay in the power. And we see what he is doing in the power. Like he is taking the people in the prison who is against his government, and he has killed his uncle. So we have a leader like that. He is a very brutal leader. And of course, that's not something which is acceptable in the system, in the democratic regime that we are having in the South Korea. So the clash of the ideology is also another important that I think is making the reunification is very important. And another thing that you said is very important, and I like at this point, that the economy factor is very important because after unification, it is the cost of the economy will be very huge. So, but I think when it comes to the economy, the willingness of reunification is less in South Korea, because these are the people, like their economy is much better compared to North Korea. And in order to balance between the two countries' economy, between the two people, so that South Korea is going to take the burden of the economy, because in terms of the infrastructure, in terms of the other things, here is much advanced than the North Korea. When it comes to the people's opinion, you also mentioned about the people's opinion. I found also some statistics that in 1994, 92% of the South Koreans, they were thinking that the reunification with the North Korea is very necessary. But the number has decreased very dramatically. In 2007, only 64% of the people in the South Korea, they were saying that the unification is necessary. In 2010, the number again decreased to 49%. So when you see the public opinion is very different. And of course, the public opinions make the government in a democratic system. So when the public opinion that's not really in the favor of the reunification, then there is not much push to the government of South Korea, although there is a minister of reunification, and that shows that, oh, actually, this, South Korea really want to have a peaceful reunification with North Korea, but still the people's mind is also very important here. As you said, the young generation, the new generations of South Korea, they see so many differences between North Korea and South Korea in terms of culture, in terms of ideology, when they separated, it was the same people, the same language, but I think now it's very different, like the way they have grown up, the way they live, the way they educate, it's totally different, and this makes it much more difficult for the two countries to reunify. So my next point is the role of the United States and the role of the other countries. As I said, they have separated with the role of the other countries, with the ideologies that they were against each other. So I think they are now also, when the unification also needs the much attention and the much efforts from every player who has a role here in the country, in this Korean Pennsylvania. The United States role is very important, and of course we need to ask that, does really the United States want to see a unified Korea? Is Japan is happy with such unification? And how about China? China is a country who is becoming and increasing its power very fast. When we see the military presence of the United States and the Korean Peninsula, we need to ask also that not many people say that the military base of the United States and the North and the South Korea is because in order to protect the South Korea. But many people also say, many experts say that it's actually the China, the United States also wants to have its power here in the region, which is very important for the United States in terms of the global competition which they have with the China. So we need to, the United States, the South Korea, in order to make much more efforts and make the unification closer, it needs to play also some roles, not only focus on North Korea to put sanctions and to isolate North Korea, but also to kind of to get more attention from the United States and other players and says that, well, this is important for us and this is what we want, if they really want the unification. But as the statistics shows that there is less willingness from the South Korean people who want to reunify. And in my conclusion, I want to say is that there is only one way that the two countries could be unified, but then of course that needs the, I think, that needs the collapse of the region, the North Korea. So when the North Korean region collapses, and I don't think that it's going to collapse by the United States military intervention, but it needs, the collapse should be from the inside. From the inside, is there anyone who can challenge the Kim Jong-un really? Now we don't really see, because he is actually eliminating every single threat to his government, like he has killed his uncle. So when we see that, so there's also very less chance for him to, for his regime to collapse. Therefore, in case he collapsed, and there would be some like chance there, so there would be the chance of reunification will increase, and the South Korea at that time also needs to have the effort with the United States to take over the control of failed states. And thank you again for your presentation. Okay.
고맙습니다. 다음 줄 피터 씨.
Yes. Thank you. I hope you can all hear me well. I think your paper was very well written, and it was a good overview of this difficult issue. One thing I like about the paper is it divides the issue between the economic side and the popular attitude side, which is the popular view of the people, as Biksa just commented, and as is clear from your paper, it's not as high as it once was. It's not as high as it could be or should be, I think is one point of your paper. I would say this though, from the main thing that I did not notice in your paper is a discussion of the nuclear problem, the nuclear issue, the nuclear weapons issue, which if we read the news almost any day, including today, it's always in the news. So I think this is the, I think it was mentioned very briefly in the beginning of the paper, but there was no more discussion of it, so maybe that could be a good idea to continue this analysis. Obviously, if North Korea continues to have nuclear weapons, the regime has a strong sense of legitimacy from its people. As far as I understand North Korea, and I'm not an expert, but that regime is not going to collapse if they have nuclear weapons, probably. that's the best we can. It's a very difficult issue. So the nuclear issue, anyway, I would encourage that analysis. The other thing I would say is this exact same issue, this exact same kind of paper, and this exact same issue has been talked about in a very similar way, seems to me, for almost 30 years, 25 years. I've read some things from as early as 1989, as soon as Germany, in 1990, as soon as Germany, East Germany opened, fell apart. They said, well, of course, Korea's next. We all know Korea's next, maybe next year, maybe next month. That was 27, 28 years ago. So I would also ask, what's new? What's new in the past 5 years, or I don't know, since Kim Jong-un came in with this issue? Has anything changed since the 90s, since 2000s? The only thing I can think of, again, is the nuclear issue. North Korea is now a nuclear power. That's changed. Obviously, we hear about that all the time. Okay, the other thing is North Korea is much more relatively poor than it was in 1989. As far as I know, the North Korean economy was still almost comparable to the South Korean as late as the 80s. But by today, it's not, we all know. So the other thing, okay, I would say this too. The economic issue, your comparison to Germany is very good, obviously. It's a very similar division story with reunification. Germany's economy today is known to be very strong. It has this image of strength, vitality, and dynamism. It's a very strong export country, as South Korea is. However, we might forget it now, especially people who are younger might not remember that Germany was called the sick man of Europe around the early 2000s. What did the sick man of Europe mean? Sick man of Europe meant an economy that was going nowhere, that had very low growth. Main reason for that was people, as far as the analysis that I've always read, says unification. Unification led to Germany being the sick man of Europe for 15 years. Is South Korea willing to become the sick man of Asia? I don't think so. So that's a big, as you said, I'd just like to stress that. I think that's the biggest popular attitude to overcome on the southern side. The other thing I would say is, what is the northern popular opinion? Do we have any idea? I think we all assume that they want unification. But I don't know how we know that. That was not addressed in your paper. That might be another thing to look into if possible. It's a closed society, we can't really know, but is the North Korean, do they want unification? If not, why not? This is something worth thinking about. Let's see. Okay. The last issue that I would like to highlight about your paper was, actually, as far as I know, there are several Korean middle school student guests today that we have. They are very young. I'm not sure their exact age, but I wonder what their thoughts on unification. People of that generation, the very youngest, let's say people in 20s and younger in Korea. I think the analysis would be helpful. What exactly is causing their lack of enthusiasm for unification? What exactly are these issues that they see? It's been a long time. 72 years since division. So they might, I don't know, they might see, the polling data that you have is not divided by age. I'm sure that there is data of this kind divided by age. This would be worth thinking of. Because as far as I know Korean politics, there's always a big age gap in every issue, it seems. So this issue was no doubt the same. So the South Korean youth view, why is it different? How big is the difference? And so on. These are things I'm not sure about and what might be worth including if possible. That's all I have. I would also, Biksud said that the regional issue is important, definitely, but this paper's strength, I think, is the not necessarily the other players, but the Koreans themselves, both North and South. Problems in within their own thinking and within their own systems of unification. So yeah, I think this is a very good paper, and thank you for it. Thank you for it.
네, 고맙습니다. 리고라 씨, 간단하게 저기 포인트가 많지만. 간략하게 답변해 주세요.
약간 외부 국가의 요민들을 중요하다고 말씀하셨는데 저도 이 말씀은 동의합니다. 예, 그 지금 한반도가 굉장히 긴장된 지역이라서 일본, 중국, 러시아, 미국의 관심이 많은 그런 지역이라서 그런 거라고 생각하는데요. 근데 일본이랑 미국이랑 중국이랑 동일에 대해서 어떻게 생각하는지 물어보셨는데 일단 일본에 대해서 얘기하자면 그 동일되기를 원한다고 생각합니다. 왜냐면 그 북한 핵무기가 발전되면서 그 제일 가까이 있는 국가라서 정체를 잘 모르겠지만 그 제일 외호만 상태에 있는 국가라고 생각해요. 그 일본이 미국에 대해서 얘기를 하면 저는 개인적으로 미국이 동의를 원하지 않는다고 생각합니다. 왜냐면 미국도 한국도 공산주의에 대한 약간 극단적인 생각을 가지고 있고 또한 아시다시피 그 미국의 무게가 미국은 동일이 될 경우에는 미국은 한국의 동일 무기를 빨지 못하게 될 거고 그거는 약간 미국의 아쉬운 점이 될 것입니다. 그래서 중국도 똑같이 중국도 물론 중국의 개인적인 관심이 있을 거고 제가 알기로는 북한이랑 경제 협력을 잘 이루고 잘 맺고 있는 나라가 중국밖에 없다고 해도 과언이 아닐 것입니다. 그래서 북한 차원이랑 북한이라는 관계가 너무 중요하기 때문에 너무 어렵습니다. 두 번째 질문은 간략하게 말씀드리고 핵무기 분석이 모자란 건지 좀 포인트고 70년간 그 리더들이 바뀌어가면서 무슨 차이가 있었는지 이렇게 질문하셨는데 핵무기 관련밖에 말씀드릴 것이 없는데요. 그리고 그 가족이라서 계속 아버지부터 아들로 넘어지는 왕국이기 때문에 계속 이렇게 공산주의도 아닌 사회주의도 아닌 약간 특별한 이런 국가라고 생각해요. 그래서 그 불김정은화가 이루어지기 전까지 어떤 변화가 있을지 모르겠습니다. 저도 뉴스를 보면서 항상 어떻게 내일 어떻게 될지 이런 생각을 하는데 저도 그 동의를 빨리 했으면 좋겠다는 이런 개인적인 생각은 했지만 불김정은화가 이루어지기 전까지는 계속 어떤 경쟁이 있을 것 같습니다. 트럼프도 그렇고 오늘도 제가 알기로는 화성 트레이닝이 있다고 들었는데 성공적인 트레이닝이라고 이렇게 뉴스에서 나왔어요. 그래서 김정은 문제는 잘 답을 못 드릴 거고 또 다른 문제는 아주 좋은 설명이 있습니다. 연령별로 한국 국민이 동일에 대한 생각이 어떤지 아쉽게도 초등학생들에 대해서 잘 모르겠지만 근데 대학생들이랑 어른들의 생각은 많이 다르다고
조사해서 봤는데요. 왜냐하면 어른들은 아직도 그걸 다 기억하고 있고 이산 가족들도 아직 존재하기 때문에 이산 가족은 동의를 원하는 사람들한테 그 가장 큰 요인이라고 생각합니다. 그래서 이산 가족들과의 관계 때문에 이런 그 어른들은 그 강세대가 더 원하는 거고 젊은이들에 대해서 얘기하지만 일단 취업난 문제가 제일 심해지고 있기 때문에 그들이 생각하는 건 정권이 지금 우리한테 일자리가 없는데 돈이 생기면 우리한테 일자리를 주는가 우리한테 세금을 어떻게 할까 이런 생각을 하고 아니면 그 돈을 동일을 하기에 동일 비용으로 쓸지 아니면 지금 취업난에 있는 아니면 뭐 아까도 나왔던 그 노인 빈곤화의 문제를 풀지 요약을 하자면 젊은이들이 지금 한국 안의 문제들을 우선적으로 생각하기 때문에 동의를 동의를 원하지 않는 건 아니고 계속 그 핵무기 발전이랑 몇 년만 지나면 그 관심이 계속 올라갔다 떨어졌다 이런 거 항상 보고 있었는데 하지만 그 또 다른 문제가 국제화 문제입니다. 그 다른 국가들은 그 어떤 뭐 한국 사람들만 한국 국민이다 이런 건 아니잖아요. 그래서 국제화가 발전되면서 이산 가족이랑 같은 민족이었기 때문에 동의를 해야 한다 이런 거 아닐까 이런 생각도 있어요. 과연 같은 민족이라서 동의를 해야 될지 아니면 지금 우리가 이렇게 따는데 같은 비가 흐르는 것도 뭐 확실하지 않잖아요. 그 중국 침략이 있었고 일본 침략이 있었고 과연 집단 추위가 이렇게 중요하다는 건 과하지 않을까 이런 생각도 있기 때문에 점점 더 멀어지고 있다고 생각합니다.
네, 고맙습니다. 네, 자 이제 청중 여러분들 의견을 받겠는데요. 먼저 저기 중학생 여러분들 오셨다고요? 네, 손 들어보세요. 중학생. 잘 왔습니다. 저희 환영하고요. 아까 그 피터 형아가 물어본 질문 있죠? 네, 중학생 여러분들도 통일을 원하나요? 원한다. 별로 원치 않는다. 모르겠다. 뭐예요? 중학생들 의견이 없나요? 좀 이따가 다시 물어볼게요. 자, 청중 여러분 질문. 네.
네, 일단 우선 준비하신 발표 정말 잘 들었고 정말 열심히 준비하셨다는 생각이 들어서 정말 좋았습니다. 일단 개인적으로 이제 우리가 통일이 어려운 문제에 대해서 내재적으로 많이 다루신 것 같아요. 그래서 개인적으로 제가 이제 아쉬운 점이 한 가지 있다면 이제 우리나라는 일제강점기를 거치면서 일본에 의해서 지배가 되었는데 이제 일본은 우리나라에서 이제 전시 상황이었기 때문에 이제 일본의 전쟁을 해서 이기기 위해서 우리나라에서 수탈을 많이 감행했고 그러한 수탈의 용의를 위해서 이제 서울 총독부를 중심으로 했던 이제 그러한 중앙 집권화가 이루어졌다고 저는 생각을 합니다. 그래서 이제 그런 중앙 집권화를 통해서 하여튼 이제 당연히 이제 한국 시민들이 반발을 하잖아요. 왜 우리가 요구하는 것을 너희한테 아무런 보상 없이 주어야 하느냐라고 많이 반발이 있었고 하지만 이제 일본은 무력으로 가져갔던 만큼 이제 일본은 어떻게 보면 이제 우리 시민들이 목소리를 낼 수 있는 수단보다 일본이 우리 시민들을 억압할 수 있는 수단이 큰 상태였습니다. 이제 그 상태에서 이제 바로 이승만 정부로 넘어가게 되면서 이제 이걸 오버디벨롭드 스테이츠라고 하면서 이제 과대성장 국가라고 하는데 이제 이 부분에서 이제 국가가 시민들 누르는 힘이 강했고 이승만 정부는 그거를 가짐으로 인해서 한국 사람들이 이제 민주화의 발전이 없기 때문에 대통령한테 어떻게 민주화의 발전이 없느냐라고 말을 했을 때 이승만 정부는 거기서 민주적으로 화답을 하기보다는 자신들이 일제 유산으로 가지고 있었던 그런 경찰력 등을 이용해서 그 사람들을 체포하는데 체포할 때의 빌미가 바로 너희들은 민주화가 아니라 공산화를 원하는 것이다 라고 하면서 일방적으로 우리와 다른 사상에 대한 것이다 라고 하면서 그들을 체포했어요. 특히 박정희 전두환 시대에는 오히려 쿠데타를 통해서 정권을 얻으면서 더욱더 강한 경찰력을 얻게 되었고 그런 것을 바탕으로 이제 우리 국민들이 말하는 민주화의 목소리를 자신들의 이제 통치의 용의를 하기 위해서 일방적으로 너희들은 북한을 따르는 사람이다. 북한 사상을 가지고 있다. 우리나라를 어지럽히고 있다. 이런 식으로 말을 하면서 이제 한국 시민들의 민주화를 막았고 이제 그렇게 이루는 계기가 되었고 이제 그 동안에 사실 이제 그런 정부들은 내 집단 편향화를 위해서 일방적으로 북한은 잘못되었다. 저런 젊은이들은 다 북한을 따르는 놈들이다 라는 식으로 교육이 이루어졌고 그런 교육이 남아있기 때문에 지금의 기득권층 혹은 지금의 노인층이 저는 통일에 반대하고 오히려 젊은층들이 찬성을 하고 있다고 생각을 해서 이제 이러한 통일의 어려운 이유에 대해서 좀 더 역사적이고 내재적인 부분을 다루었으면 조금 더 좋은 발표가 되었을 거라고 생각을 하고 개인적으로 이렇게 궁금한 이유는 외지적 이유를 전혀 다루시지 않으셨던데 이제 사실 저는 통일을 못하는 이유가 한국과 북한 내재적으로 서로 갈등이 일어나서가 아니라 미국이나 중국이 서로 반대해서라고 생각을 하는 입장이 더 큽니다. 사실 이번에 사드를 한국에 들어온다고 했을 때 북한의 핵무기가 발전을 했으니 미국의 기술을 빌려서 우리가 북한의 핵우산을 만들겠다 이런 식으로 발언했는데 사실 보복을 하고 있는 건 북한이 아니라 중국 쪽이지 않습니까? 사실 이 부분에서 미국의 무기를 들여와서 한국을 북한으로부터 방어하겠다는데 왜 중국이 반발을 하냐면 사실 사드라는 무기 자체가 중국이 혹시나 미국과 전쟁이 일어났을 때 미국으로 쏘는 핵을 한국의 1차적으로 미사일 방어선 사드를 이용해서 불시에 맞겠다 이런 의미를 통해서 미국은 북한을 빌미로 하고 있고 중국은 남한을 빌미로 서로 맞고 있는 걸 이제 합류하고 있다고 생각을 하거든요. 이제 니구라 씨는 혹시 이런 외재적 요인에 대해서는 다루시지 않으셨던데 이런 요인에 대해 어떻게 생각하는지 좀 개인적으로 궁금합니다.
얘기하기나 무슨 국제관계학이 아니고 그러니까 일반 대학생의 시각으로 왜 한국 통일이 잘 안 될까 그런 건 그렇고 이제 뭐 역사나 그다음에 뭐 외재적인 거죠 뭐 주변 환경이나 이제 그런 것들은 아까도 좀 일부 답변도 하셨기 때문에 충분히 답변이 된 것 같고 나중에 그 점심 시간에 또 더 얘기를 하시는 게 좋을 것 같아요.
아, 제가 물어봐야 되는데 제가
누가요?
그 주신 질문.
일단 점심 한번 물어보세요. 그다음에 네, 저기
Thank you so much for
남자분 먼저 아까 손 들었어요.
He's giving me the microphone.
It's okay.
Thank you, Atawa.
Gentleman.
Yeah, he's a great friend of mine. Thank you so much for the presentation. It was, I think, quite useful information for all of us. But unfortunately, I didn't hear anything about the Sunshine Policy, which was very important towards the North Korea from the South Korean perspective and from the South Korean policy in order to warm up relationship between these two parties, first. Second, I heard from the Mikzad comments on the situation that it would be a burden for the South Korea to unify with the North Korea, but we all know that South Korean technology and North Korean resources can be a really, really powerful instrument in the Asian area, we would say. Like, for example, I would say that South Korea itself, we can consider it as an island because it's not even peninsula itself because it's not really connected territorially to the Eurasian continent. But if it's going to be united And we all know that there is some special procedure on the rehabilitation of the people. And we all know even after unification, they will not open directly the borders, but prepare the transition from that part to the south part. Obviously, the borders would not be open immediately, and those North Korean people will enter the South Korea, because a lot of South Korean people are fear of the things that they are thinking, that a lot of people will come and will take the jobs and etc. But we all know that there are some specific procedures in order to follow the full unification process and procedure itself. So my question is about the Sunshine Policy, and what do you think about this? So what would be actually applicable for this situation?
네, 감사합니다. 잠시 저기 우리 원래 두 번째 세션이 11시 40분까지 예정돼 있었는데 이미 시간이 넘겼거든요. 그러니까 저기 남자분 질문까지 받고 같이 답을 하시죠.
네, 답변을 잘 들었고요. 근데 질문을 안 읽은 걸 알겠습니다. as Mr. Begzad mentioned about the variety of two sides regime, so for, if the deal be like the democratization and communistization of two parts, what significant elements you think must be act to satisfy the North side for their democratization, and if the deal be like the South side to be communistized, what do you think? Is the South is ready to be communistized or no? That was my question.
양쪽 체제에 대해서 질문하셨는데 군사화 되면은 그 좋은 점도 있습니다. 군사화가 되면 한반도의 그 군사적 힘이 세질 거라고 생각하기 때문에 예.
Because I asked like the do you think in the future or maybe next future or far future the South part will be ready for communistization, or what significant elements the South side must add in order to satisfy the North regime for their democratization? Yeah, that was my question. Did you get the point?
죄송한데 저도 좀 질문을 이해하기 힘든데
Yeah, I think I got this question. This question is like, in order if the two countries got unified, so is the South Korea is ready to become a communist country like the North Korea? And is the North Korea ready to become a democratic country like South Korea?
Yeah. But before unification,
yeah.
That should be an element for unification. So before unification, you can explain that as well. So if the South part want to, if the North part want the South part to be in communism system, so how far South part is ready to accept that from North, and what significant elements should be asked from South part in order to satisfy the North part to accept the democracy? That was the point for unification, of course.
동의를 하면 세 가지 방법이 있는데 한번 아예 북한이 남한의 정리권을 받아들이고 세 번째는 어떤 뭐 헌법을 수정하든가 뭐 이런 새로운 새로운 종류의 정권을 만들든가 아니면 세 번째 컨피더레이션을 만들어서 북한은 그대로 공산주의로 남고 그냥 근데 세 번째 정권은 한국에게 약간 불이익하기 때문에 그냥
네, 그리고 뭐죠? 소셜 팔러스에 대한 그 답변은 논의는 거기 점심시간에 또 하는 걸로 합시다. 왜냐하면 지금 이제 세 번째 세션을 시작하기 좀 시간이 넘었기 때문에요. 어쨌든 니콜라 씨 수고해 주셨습니다. 자, 마지막 자, 그러면은 저기 마지막 발표자 에릭 라이언 버거 씨의 발표 듣도록 하겠습니다.
It's kind of like riding a roller coaster. You have no idea. You just gotta go in and go. I know I'll survive, but it's quite scary. I don't know why there's a thing on the screen. Okay, so the topic of my presentation is foreigners navigating a Confucian social order. But, you know, I've lived in Korea for the past 6.5 years or so, and a common question, a common topic of conversation that keeps coming up amongst my foreigner friends and Korean friends alike are some of these complaints, some of complaints about Korean culture. Why is it so difficult to live here? These different things. And so this is a question that I keep asking myself. I've asked for over 6 years. And then attending this conference, the Korean Friendship Conference, I asked it again, but more in kind of in an academic way. Really, what is happening? Why are so many foreigners complaining about these cultural differences living in South Korea? Now, to be sure, I couldn't really get this all done in a short research paper. There's nothing out there. There's no texts written about foreigners kind of confronting a Korean culture and the complaints that they have and everything else. Like, all of these conversations are happening over drinks, over dinners, in a very casual way outside of work. But it's a question that I tried to tackle in this paper, and in the short amount of time that I had to write it and put together this presentation, you'll see what I kind of came up with. To be sure, and I mentioned this in a footnote in my paper, that to do this in a very authentic and positive way, one really needs to go out and formally and scientifically interview 100 or 200 different foreigners living and working in South Korea and ask them some deep questions about what is difficult about living in South Korea? Why are there these cultural differences and what causes them? But for my presentation, I did some informal interviews with some friends and colleagues, and this is what I came up with here. First of all, I found that in the 6.5 years that I've lived here, Koreans are very warm and caring people. They'll go out of their way to make a foreigner feel welcome. I've been welcomed into Korean homes, I've been given gifts. Without a doubt, it's been the most positive 6.5 years of my life living here. But it begs the question, why do so many foreigners living in South Korea complain about these cultural differences. And like I said, this is happening in a casual setting. You hear it all the time, or at least I do. As one Russian woman puts it, a Russian company worker living and working here in South Korea, she says, "All I see is gender discrimination. It doesn't matter how much I value to the company or how much I contribute to my company." An American professor mentioned that gerontocracy is a real problem in Korea. And this is, gerontocracy is a system where elders are ruling everything. A form of social organization in which a group of old men or a council of elders dominates or exercises control. An American teacher once expressed to me that no matter how hard he tried to improve a curriculum at his school, the principal insisted that his way wasn't the, quote, Korean way, and that, quote, "we do things differently in Korea than in American schools." And furthermore, that principal never actually sat down with the teacher to really hear through his ideas. He just, the principal immediately, immediately dismissed the ideas. So we see this Korean way. To be sure, not 100% of Korean culture is discriminatory in these ways. There are many examples of Koreans that value people's contribution and capability over their age, gender, and culture. As I mentioned before, Koreans overall will go out of their way to make a foreigner feel welcome. So while I attempt to understand why so many foreigners living in South Korea complain about these cultural differences, I am very well aware that these complaints don't represent Korean culture as a whole. I do feel, however, that there is some conflict happening, which creates misunderstandings, feelings of uncomfortableness, disrespect. So where does this conflict come from? Of course, we can all agree that when living in a different country that's not your own, there is going to be cultural differences, misunderstandings, hard feelings. It's perfectly natural, of course. But for our purposes, we need to look why these conflicts are happening specifically in a South Korean context. So let me share just a quick personal story that kind of illustrates this misunderstanding and kind of a conflict that's happened. I used to work at a middle school. I used to teach English in Incheon at a middle school there. And in the teacher's office, you can see all the blue squares here are different teachers' desks. You can see where I'm at, me, next to the hallway. And the vice principal is up at the head of the office. Now, one day, while all the other teachers were out, they were teaching other classes, and I had some planning time, I had a question about the semester. Exactly when does vacation start and how I should plan my semester. And I looked over and the vice principal is sitting at her desk. So I figured, I'll just go ask her. So I got up and walked over to the vice principal's desk and I asked her in my kind of shoddy Korean. And we worked it out and she answered the question and she showed me on her calendar. And I went back to my desk and I figured there was no big deal. But later, the blue square right next to me is my co-teacher. She came back in, and immediately the vice principal called her up to her desk and explained some kind of hard issues to her. And when my co-teacher came back to her desk, she seemed really upset, kind of bothered by something. But she immediately turned to me and said, "Why did you go to the vice principal and ask her about vacation?" I said, "Oh, well, there was no one else here, and I wanted to ask." She said, No. This is not the way we do it. You must ask me first, and if I don't know the answer, then I will ask the English head, and then I will ask the vice principal. There's a hierarchy that you must follow." And I was like, "Oh, well, I'm very sorry." But I can tell that it was very uncomfortable, not only for me, but for my co-teacher and for the vice principal. There was some conflict here. So, while after work, I went to a Korean friend and I asked him, why did this happen? What was going on here? My Korean friend said that, "Oh, this is Korean culture." And I'm like, "Okay." And that's pretty much his answer. And he said, "You cannot just go up to the vice principal and ask her some questions. You have to follow the order." And he explained it as it's Korean culture. So my question is, what is this Korean culture? What is it exactly? Yeah. So as I said before, during the 6.5 years I've lived here in Korea, I've heard these countless stories from other foreigners encountering different situations where they felt uncomfortable, unwanted, generally disrespected because of this, quote, Korean culture. And teachers and company workers alike share similar stories of their voice not being heard, having to follow the hierarchy, and not being included in some meetings. One elementary school teacher stated that he is always the last to know about important schedule changes, sometimes just minutes before the changes occur. Another company worker complained that at the company dinners, the hoeshiks, where she feels uncomfortable because the superior is always forcing drinks on her. And when she refuses, her superior says, oh, this is our culture, as an excuse to push more drinks on her. Simply backing out of the company dinner, I asked her, this is not an option. Another teacher told a story where his vice principal and other teachers told him he must sing at a norebang because it's part of the culture. And I can account for many other stories, the list goes on. But not only foreigners are uncomfortable, I've heard similar stories from Koreans complain about these type of situations. For example, a teacher was working 60 or more hours a week without any extra compensation. She was suffering from fatigue, and her health was becoming a serious problem. You could see it on her face. When asked why she didn't complain to her superiors about this, she simply stated that it was Korean culture. This is the way it is done. So what is this Korean culture? What is it about Korean culture that makes foreigners feel uncomfortable or misunderstood or disrespected? Well, in order to understand this, we need to kind of go back a little bit into some history. Korean culture is a Confucian culture. And Ms. Bohae-Sol-Wan kind of touched on this a little bit about her gender inequalities based on this Confucian structure. And I would argue that it simply is a Confucian culture. In about 1392, under Yi Song-ye, the state ideology was made into a Confucian culture, and from 1392 until 1910, through the Japanese occupation, through the war, it has remained a Confucian. Confucian ethics stresses the importance of the relationship between ruler and subject, man and woman, boss and employee. Specific rituals, customs define these relationships, and if not performed accurately and faithfully, a person could suffer some dire consequences. For example, in 1791, Yun Chi-chung, who accepted a budding Catholic teaching that was coming in from the Jesuits through China, refused to perform an ancestor ritual for his mother, claiming it to be against the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church. The ancestor rite is an extremely important ritual in Confucianism and illustrates the importance of honoring the hierarchy within blood ties. A scholar, Chang, states that the essence of today's family rites in Korea is essentially Confucian, according to this tradition of ritual propriety, Yi and Li. The Korean legacy of ancestral rites developed along with family moral spiritual values, especially filial piety and family love. Yun, in 1791, was executed for not performing the sacred ancestor rite. After that, a horrendous persecution of all foreign doctrines was carried out by the edge of a sword. This cartoon comes from a Korean history book for middle school students. That's what I read. But you can see that this kind of clash between Confucian ideology and a more Western Catholic ideology happening here. Dan Cumming states in his Korean history that much of what we now reckon as Korean culture or Korean tradition was the result of a major social reorganization accomplished by self-conscious ideologies who got going in the 15th century. What started out as a military putsch by General Yi ended up centuries later in the apparent solidity of a hierarchical Confucian society, much like the one Westerners first encountered. So to be sure, as we talk about today, this ritual and social practice of Confucianism is of course relaxed. We're not having executions anymore. And it's very relaxed compared to a pedantic form of the late Joseon. But it is without a doubt that it is very present to this day. The Confucianism that was implemented under Yi Song-ye in the late 14th century grew deep roots in the peninsula. And while foreign ideologies, doctrines, and religions are now widely accepted in South Korea, a Confucian tint is given to all relationships and social ordering. We can see this tint, in three different Confucian customs. We can see this in daily life in South Korea. The first is the bow, or bowing, which we're all very accustomed to. What kind of bow is needed is based on one's social position in relation to the person one is bowing to, and the reason for the bow. Another thing we can see is the form of language. Who one can and cannot speak to, what form of language they need to use, according to whom they're speaking to, and the rank that the person has, or the position in society. How one relates to superiors and juniors based on position within the workplace, age, and gender, where one sits in an office setting, or in a social gathering, serving and eating food, serving and drinking alcohol. The list goes on. This is my theory. This is just my opinion. Like, a simple look at a Korean company dinner pouring drinks. If you look at the company dinner, the way that the custom is of pouring soju, pouring drinks, the respect that they extend to one another based on their relationship, the language they use between each other, this will demonstrate all of these rituals and customs in a microcosmic form. Extend this drinking custom outwardly into a company setting, on campus, in a classroom, and you can clearly see this Confucian social order macrocosmically at play in all sectors of society. A couple of examples of this Confucian order taking play within the company, Korean society. A Korean company worker was once asked by his boss that he needs to play golf in order to appease his boss and to appease his customers. After countless hours of practice and a cracked rib, he still proclaims that, I must do this. I cannot make any mistake in front of my boss. Another company employee stated, hungover after a long night of drinking soju and beer with his boss, that I must do this in order to survive in a competitive society. Now, this type of behavior can be seen all over the world, right? We can see it. We can see it in America. People doing things to please their boss, doing things that they don't want to do, but. These two examples, when asked, they can say that it comes from a Confucian ethic. It comes from this type of society. But foreigners coming into this Confucian society have no place to go. Whoops, didn't go. Well, it's supposed to be animated. Sorry. Sorry. The little foreigner's supposed to bounce around because he has no place. She has no place to go. But anyways, foreigners coming into this Confucian society really have no place to go to. At first, it's confusing to both the Korean and foreigners. Foreigners are generally assumed to be outside of this social order, which means they have little to no opinion or voice in the workplace. This is because generally foreigners do not understand these rituals and customs that come into play. Koreans can all abide by these customs very easily, so the foreigners cannot compete. But Confucianism may not be the state ideology these days, and it's not the national religion. And South Korean nowadays practice Confucian ritual and custom without a mere thought to it. Bowing to superiors, knowing when and what form of language to use, how to behave around peers and colleagues based on age, gender, etc. Sitting in the appropriate spot in relation to their peers and colleagues, serving and consuming food and drinks. Foreigners introduced into this gauntlet of ritual and custom can face a lot of awkward situations. Uncomfortable feelings, disrespect, and the feeling of being left out. Confucian culture is not going to disappear, nor should it. Really, Confucian culture at its core is thought generally to see the world to be transformable. It calls for a return to human virtue, views the political realm in moral terms, teaches fundamental human values and relationships, articulates their proper social roles, and emphasizes self-cultivation as the universal foundation. It's the backbone of Korean society. Foreigners entering into this culture for the first time should come prepared. They need to come with ample patience and understanding. Foreigners need to spend the time and extend the respect to Koreans to learn these rituals and customs of Confucianism. this can be as easy as sitting down with your Korean friends over a shared meal and just discussing, you know, the ins and outs of navigating a Korean Confucian social order. Also, spending time to learn the language, of course, to do their best to abide by the culture will help foreigners go a long way in succeeding in Korea. But on the other hand, Koreans, if they truly want to exist in an ever-globalizing society, need to understand that some of the more pedantic Confucian rituals and customs are simply unnecessary to insist on foreigners and Koreans alike. It is very true that more and more Koreans, especially those of the younger generation, are embracing a more global understanding of their world. They can bounce between the conservative Confucian order of their company or workplace and the more international flavor of social interaction. Those younger Koreans need to stand up at times and question the old order of Confucianism, Confucian custom and ritual that coerces or discriminates against people rather than promotes balance and harmony. But balance is needed between these two worlds. Foreigners need to lean into Confucian custom and rituals, while Koreans need to lean into international cultures they are coming to face with in this globalizing culture. Leaning against each other, as we are doing here at this Next Generation Conference, Koreans and foreigners coming to work and study in Korea can help galvanize Korea and make it a more hospitable and welcoming place for all people to live and work. Thank you very much.
Sex trafficking도 컴퓨션즘 때문이고 굉장히 awkward 이런 것들도 컴퓨션즘 때문이고 아무튼 먼저 그 노준수 씨 네, 코멘트 주세요.
Thank you for the presentation. And reading through your essay and looking at watching you present, I actually came into several questions that I wanted to ask you. One thing is that I saw generally, I think it is dangerous to generalize Korean culture as a Confucian one. And I think, like from my perspective, this presentation was generalizing Confucianism as a whole in some sense. First, your example of a foreigner being posed in an outer circle of Korean society, I think it could be from Confucian culture, but it also could be because Korea is a mono-ethnic society. Like, other races have really no place to be because Korean people are consisted of only Koreans. And if you could look into different factors, it would have been much better, and it would have been much more convincing, I think. For example, from your essay, you mentioned that Korean society is very competitive, and that's what I feel too. As a Korean, I feel that Korean society is very hyper competitive, and at the same time, it has military culture all over the workplaces, because if you think about it, every Korean men are directly or indirectly exposed to a military environment because most of them usually go to the Army or Navy or the Air Force, and basically, everyone is indirectly exposed to military culture. If you think about it, Korean people sit around the living room and watch stars going into the boot camp and as a show. So it's a really common culture. And since it is such a hyper-competitive society, people rather choose to comply with whatever there is in the workplace, because if you lose a job, there is a very low chance of getting another job. So I think that part explains how I thought Korean generalizing Korean culture as a Confucian culture is a little dangerous, because it is more of a Korean culture being abusive to social minors and not the Confucian one. And I wanted to ask if the Confucian culture of Korea is distinctly different from foreigners getting adjusted to the other cultures, because when I first went to the United States to study, I was like 13 or something, and I had a hard time being scolded by teachers. Of course, it is hard to be scolded by teachers, but in Korea, you shouldn't really make any eye contact being scolded by your parents or your teachers. So I was taught that way. And then now I'm 13, went to the United States, being scolded, looking down on my, on the ground, and they called me on showing disrespect to them. So I was like, well, I was taught this way, what's the problem? And I told them that. But after that, I had so much of a hard time trying to look into their eyes because I was taught that it is a sign of disrespect. So I wanted to know if Confucian culture is so much different from other cultures, like being adjusted to other cultures. And from your essay, you said Confucianism rejects other culture. Well,
where do I say it
rejects other cultures? I'll report. Mm-hmm. Well, I can't really find it, but I saw it. I'm sorry.
I think the doctrines was the right one. Rejects other doctrines.
Other doctrines, okay. Wait a sec. Yeah, that part I do have something to say about because Confucian rulers, not only in Korea but also in other countries, were not so rejective to other doctrines because, for example, Kangxi Emperor of Qing Dynasty was trying to show that value, virtues and values of Confucian ruler in order to be accepted as a legitimate emperor. He was grateful of Jesuits for teaching science innovations and Western knowledge, and he was accepting of Christian, but you are right in this sense because they ended up rejecting Christian ideologies because Christian ideologies do not permit Confucian ceremonies or ancestor worships, but he actually issued an edict of toleration in order to help them spread their beliefs. And Regent Hongsan, who was famous for a closed-door policy of Joseon, he actually was not against Catholic Church. In fact, he was looking for a diplomatic maneuvering by accepting Catholicism to get help from France to keep Russia in check. However, political environment and general norm of Qing Dynasty to reject Catholicism and failure to form an alliance with France led to the failure of such maneuver. So that was a part that I thought generalization about Confucianism as a whole is a little dangerous. I don't know if I made a whole lot of sense, but that's what I wanted to tell you about.
Right. So, first of all, I just wanted to say, I think you did a really good job of combining your theoretical exploration of Confucianism with the more fieldwork-oriented research approach with your interviews and personal anecdotes. So now I'm going to go and summarize some of the points that I found more interesting in your talk, and also bring up some questions and ideas that I had about things that would be interesting if you were to pursue this issue in greater depth. So first of all, I really appreciated the point you made about inserting oneself within the hierarchy and how that might be difficult for a foreigner. Because in Korea, from the moment someone is born, they're placed within the society. They have their family, they have their grandparents, they're viewing the way in which people are interacting with one another. And then you go to school, you get a job, and everything kind of has this trajectory that's been set up for you, and you can kind of see yourself within a larger context. But if you're a foreigner and you arrive in Korea, often sight unseen, with little knowledge of the society, as I suspect many foreigners who arrive here do, it's challenging because not only do you have to assess your place, you might have a job set up, but other than that, there's a lot, to figure out on the spot. And then, okay, the next point that I thought was interesting was the way in which you described how kind of certain xenophobic elements might have been infused with Korean Confucianism during the Joseon period. And I also would have liked to hear more hear a little bit more about that, because I thought that was interesting. I'll touch more on that in a moment. And finally, the fact that you commented on how many Koreans in the workforce specifically might have difficulties with certain cultural customs. And so now I'm going to go into some of my comments on these topics. So first of all, there was one important thing that you brought up, which was a quote from the Russian woman, which is that she said, "All I see is gender discrimination." And I think it would have been interesting to hear a little more about this, because you didn't really talk too much about how gender discrimination might play a role in Korean culture, or more specifically, their treatment of foreigners. And we saw a lot about this from Bohessa's presentation, I think that would be an interesting thing to see, and because there might be, you know, certain difficulties that female foreigners face that might be different, entirely different, or more challenging than the ones male foreigners face. And going off that, some foreigners might experience different difficulties from others. I think that there's like few distinctions made here between, for example, upper echelon white collar jobs and more blue collar labor oriented jobs, and also jobs designed for English speakers, such as maybe teaching English, and jobs where you're expected to be fluent in Korean or proficient in some other sort of skill. And so I think it would be interesting to see kind of how the foreigner experience differs among these different groups of workers, because you know, as I think that there's about 1 million foreign workers in Korea now, and I think a pretty high number of these are actually manual laborers doing very kind of low income jobs, and so I'd be curious to see how like maybe these types of workers are feeling as foreigners. Whether they're feeling more or less welcome, or whether or not their jobs are kind of better for them here than it's been in Korea, than it was in their home countries. So I guess another point I have is going off what Rudin said, is how do you differentiate between general culture shock and the experience of kind of adjusting to new life, and figuring out if there's something that's specifically inherent to Korean society that might make things more challenging. For example, actually, I'll move on from that. And another thing is that we were examining with this paper kind of why do foreigners complain about life in Korea? And I want to qualify this because I'm kind of curious if we investigated more specific examples of discrimination and kind of things such as maybe wage gaps or the unemployment rate or the rate at which people lose their jobs or experience, you know, more severe quantifiable problems, because I think that there might be a common tendency of foreigners to kind of, you know, at the dinner table complain about their work life, be like, oh my gosh, I experienced this surprising cultural issue, haha, but it might not actually be something that really negatively affected their lives in the long term or their overall work trajectory in Korea. So I'd be curious to see if, you know, if we have data, it might be difficult to find about, you know, these more quantifiable issues that might be posing more significant challenges to foreigners. So I think that about wraps up what I have to say. Thank you.
자, 백희 씨, 시각글로 담당하셨으니까 짧게 답변해 주세요.
Yes. First of all, I'd like to be very, very clear, and I think I tried to do this in my paper. I'm not generalizing the Korean culture. The very first point that I pointed out is that Koreans generally are very welcoming and very warm to me, and these problems, though they might seem insignificant, they happen. But you know, these are cases that are coming out here and there, you know. But they happen enough that it begs the question. So definitely, you know, I don't want to generalize the entire Korean culture. I know that there are a lot of teachers, professors, and my Korean friends, and Koreans in general that, you know, don't abide by this kind of discriminatory Confucian ethic. And you say that maybe it was just because of this mono-ethnicity. Well, why is there mono-ethnicity? I claim that it's because of a Confucian system that was instated in the 14th century. And because it was instated and through over the time, it wasn't an immediate thing. It wasn't like in 1392, boom, the state ideology was Confucian. It happened over a few centuries and over several rulers and everything else, but it became deepened and ingrained, and it became to reject other doctrines. And this is the evidence that I found in my research. Now, I don't have a time machine. I can't go back and find out exactly what happened, but this is what I read in my research. Of course, there have been many examples throughout history of Koreans being very interested in Western ideas. This is why the Catholic Church is so still prominent in Korean society today, because there were a lot of Koreans very interested in these outside ideals and welcomed them. The other thing that I didn't have time to go into in my paper, because really it's impossible to try and to tackle, is the difference between Chinese Confucianism and Korean Neo-Confucianism, and the differences between these two and the ethics that come into play with that. You know, reading over these things, like, I tried to include them in some forms of my paper, but you know, in the time frame that I was given, it was pretty daunting to take. I'm very interested, though, what you said about the military culture. It's one thing that I haven't put a lot of thought into, and I think that it might have a lot to say about it. But then again, within the military culture, they're following a Confucian social order within the military culture.
Military culture is different.
Yeah, but I think they still have the position and the rank, and within that culture, they still follow the protocol and the respect given to each rank. Of course, all militaries are like that throughout the world. Your example of going to America and the eye contact story, that's very interesting. Let me say, of course, any foreigner moving to any other country in the world is going to experience cultural differences. And they're gonna be because of, you know, an American ideology or a Confucian ideology or whatever ideology, but for my purposes, I was just trying to find out. I hear these different stories happening over and over, and I think it's because of a Confucian ethic that is within Koreans that may or may not be realized or conscious. They might not be conscious of. What else? And Sinclair's comments. Yes, the gender discrimination is an important topic, and again, I wish I had time to go into it all, but I just wanted to kind of generalize that these are some problems. And I think Bohesawan really touched on that. The gender discrimination within the sex trafficking is very real, but take that within just to the common workplace, the situations that are a little bit more closer to us, it's still very predominant. You can see it in Korean dramas, you can see it in the workplace, and I hear it on a daily basis, these kind of situations where women are discriminated against just because of their gender, not just foreigners, Korean women. And you make a good point of the different types of foreigners that are in Korea. I have friends, most of my friends, of course, are kind of a white Anglo-Saxon, English-speaking folks. Of course, we're white collars, we're students, and we're studying here. But I've also had friends, Vietnamese friends, Philippine friends, that are working in factories in Incheon and other ways, and other areas that also really, even in a more severe case, are struggling because of the social order that they're placed into immediately upon arrival into this country. But again, the situation is not unique to South Korea. It's everywhere, yeah. The difference between general culture shock and Korean society, yeah, it's kind of hard. But we have to ask, why does culture shock happen? Culture shock happens in America because of an American ideology of a certain way. Why does culture shock happen in Korea? I beg to say that it's because of a Confucian ethic, a Confucian social order. I'll stop there.
고맙습니다. 자, 이제 청중 여러분들 자유롭게 질문이나 코멘트 해주세요. 네.
It was very interesting presentation, and I have a couple of questions for you. We have proverb, the fish dies from the head. So, in your opinion, could you tell like that? Maybe you could see as one of the solutions, for example, to change this from the top to bottom, or you believe from the not only to from the top to bottom, but from the bottom to the top approach, or maybe you don't believe in this at all. Maybe you don't think that Korean society really needs to change it. So could you please tell your opinion? Like, do the Korean society really suffer from it? If yes, then how they can change it and. Because I heard from you that from your presentation some ideas that the Korean even mono ethnicity society up till now, but slowly and gradually turns into more diversity positive society. So maybe you think and you would suggest something with that. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your question. The fish dies from the head. Is that what you said? That's very interesting. I don't know. I don't think we need to kill Confucianism. If Confucianism is the fish in this analogy, we don't need to kill it. Confucianism is a very beautiful philosophy. And I wish I had time to go into that, too. It promotes harmony and balance and filial piety and respect for elders. I mean, raise your hand if you give up your seat to an elder on the subway or on the bus. Okay, is that Confucian or is that just general common sense? I mean, we need to look at the common sense of Confucianism, the basic beautiful points of it, and keep these things. But I also think that the superiors in this gerontocratic society, some of the elders and older people are gonna use this Confucian principles to hold down people and put them in their position. Like the Russian woman I use as an example, she offers so much to her company, and she contributes a lot, but she feels that she is not able to move forward because of her gender. And so I think that these elements, we don't need to kill a fish by the head, but maybe we need to kill a few fish in the larger pond of Confucianism. Is that a cool, I don't know, that works.
I will just quickly add, I also do believe that Confucianism is a very beautiful legacy. That you have to that Korean society inherit and that they have to pass through and to pass to the next generation. But my point was that, as you said, the gerontocracy, that some privileged people like just make it in their own use. For example, maybe overusing in some ways and etc. But the thing is, I would want to point that it mostly is like more oppressing the some like. Societies, groups, or whatever is there. But my point was like, it's something that you have to really save it. But that the fish itself was something which is negatively affecting. That was my point.
Yeah, I hear you. But, yeah,
and
chop its head off.
And plus about the Russian woman, I do believe that the Korean society is very stereotyping society. Like, you can really see here, despite some already amount of foreigners here in South Korea, you could see a lot of stereotypization of other foreigners. For example, Russian women here As in the previous presentation with you, I think I haven't seen it, but I couldn't predict that they are like very much involved in the prostitution as well. So you could already see like this Russian woman is not only genderly discriminated, like there was not only gender discrimination, but also she was sexually objectivized in that case. So we could see that there is a lot of stereotypes also that foreigners are facing in this country. Same as the Koreans and us and me as Asian facing in the West world as a yellow and whatever is there. So it's another big issue that
okay,
maybe it's
감사합니다.
Another topic for the presentation.
네, 다른 분들한테 기회를 줘야 되니까 그 뭐 우리 스팟 안 해도 될 것 같아요. 오케이. 그 두 분이 손을 들었는데 저 여자분 한 분 맞죠? 네, 먼저 하시고 그다음에 여기 남자분 그다음에 하시고.
Thank you for your presentation. I really like the point that you made about microcosmic kind of model and as you described, but I have a kind of comment considering the general structure of your work. I feel like you were talking mostly about social order in the workplace. So I think you should really divide it between social order and Confucian Korean culture. So Confucian elements in Korean culture. So. I've been exposed to Korea for the past 5 years, and problems that were rooted in the social order, they're like 1%. All other problems, as the second commenter mentioned, it was probably because I'm a Russian girl, and people would grab me by the hand and not my French friend, because she's French. And I think that the problem that kind of you have is that just like many Korean people, you assume that a foreigner is a white, probably American, maybe European man. And all of the negative things that foreigners might say about Korea, in a workplace, yes, maybe they come from social order, but in a lot of cases, they're not coming from this. So I think you should have specified particularly that you're dealing with workplace maybe, then I wouldn't have so many questions. So, do you think you can specify, or do you think you can go broader?
I'll try and keep this short. Yeah, you know, that's an interesting point that you make about the difference between the workplace order and the social order. I guess that in my understanding, or in my opinion, the kind of Confucian ethic is everywhere and is in the workplace, it's in the casual setting. I mean, a Korean friend and I just had kind of a little bit of a debate the other night about this kind of topic, and believe me, it's a debate and it's not conclusive at all. But I told him, I said, you know, when you go out just with a friend, and your friend reaches across the table to pour a soju for you or pour a beer, and they do this, I say, that's Confucian. It comes from a Confucian thing. And he's like, no, this is just our culture. I'm like, yeah, well, it comes from Confucianism. It comes from this, a sign of respect. And if you take that to another step, and if you're having a meal with your boss, then that respect is going to be even shown more. And this is just in a social setting. If you take that and extend it into a workplace environment, then it's going to be even more by the case. It's hard for me to speak in deep about it because I'm not Korean. So maybe that's the problem. I don't know.
What do you think?
제 의견을 밝히는 거는 시간 문제도 있고 점심시간에 자 그 끝으로 그러면 좀 시간도 많이 지났고 그 패널 여러분들 중에 혹시 뭐 질문이나 의견을 말씀해 주실 분 있으면 전 세션도 좋고요. 네. 네, 주영 씨 그 아까 두 번째 세션 북한 통일 문제 말해가지고 네.
So thank you for giving me a time in this time constraint sessions. I do have a follow-up on Mr. Peter Jewell's comments because he asked about the data analysis and I was on a team with Seoul National University analyzing the Tongil unification survey based on age by age groups, and then it shows that there was a lot of controversy that Korean 20s has been conservatized, so-called 한 20대 보수화, But then the conclusion was that Korean 20s has not been conservative in the terms of like typical traditional conservative words, but then it's a new whole group. They are different from the Korean traditional conservative group, which is like 50s, 60s, 70s in two sense. First, they are more pessimistic about unifications, but then, and unification and a government aid to North Korea, but then they are also pessimistic about unifications. And they see unification not as an end itself, but then as a method. Over 50% are against unification, and even for those who are for unification says that they want unification because they think that it's good for their economy, or they think that it's good for their it's good for national power. So it's not the end itself as it was for the elders who has the brotherhood with the people in North Korea, but then it's kind of like math though to establish another goal. So it's a whole different characteristics. And then given that, I believe that there may be the days that we have to restate the question from how should we reunify to the do we really want to unify? So there will be days that coming these and then, just like one more. Because he also talked about nuclear weapons, and I took one whole year studying nuclear weapons with Professor Kyle Beersley. So he asked that what has been changed from then, and then I'll say one, two, 3 things. First of all, nuclearization progress has been further improved. They succeeded in miniaturizations. Over 100 kilograms of plutonium. They are suspected to have a second secret place of plutonium processing plant. And second of all, the credibility of China as an ally has been decreased throughout the history. And then lastly, the credibility of US. Even US does not want to provide a security guarantee. They say security guarantee is an exit to enter into this negotiation. North Korea has to give up the nuclear weapons first, and then they're going to give a security guarantee. But the North Korea already spread the vice versa. Even the United States want to give a security guarantee to North Korean elites and regimes, I severely doubt that the credibility of U.S. security guarantees, since there have been a lot of like broken negotiations. For example, agreed framework in 1994, they walked away, promises has been not kept, and taken all these three elements together, I say things have been changed, but then not in a positive way.
네, 하영 씨, 짧게 해주세요.
In the unification part, I think the former president Park Geun-hye's the discourse of the so-called Tomil Daebangneum, the unification is Bonanza, was a kind of an effort. I don't know whether that came from Choi Soon-sil or not, but there was a kind of effort to turn the tide of the discourse on unification from the negative one to the positive one. But that wasn't that it wasn't that powerful. And then I think we have to ask why it wasn't that powerful to the many young Korean people. And I think one of the reasons why is that young Korean people have kind of belief in that the liberal democracy and capitalism system has won in the history. And we do not think we have to sacrifice these values for unification. So that's probably one of the big reasons. And then I also have to ask, does North Korea want unification? Because unification has a counterpart, and then they are not Hanminjok or Joseonminjok, but they now are called, they are Kim Il-sung Minjok. So they have different kind of, they are building different kind of national identity, and then I think this will be a great problem to Korean unification. Then maybe we should start asking, do we really need unification without solving all the problems and with sacrificing all the values that we have achieved for the past 7 years. And then last point of last presentation, I think you are not generalizing Korean culture, I agree with that, but I think you are kind of doing the generalization of foreigners. Who the foreigners are you talking about here? Are they just Westerners or American people? Or are they just the visitors, travelers, or are they workers in Korea? So I think those things must be first clarified to deal with the issues.
네, 고맙습니다. 저기 점심 같이 제공해 주시죠? 네, 우리 점심시간에 그 또 더 많은 얘기를 나누긴 하고요. 저기 그 참가해 주신 여러분들 대단히 감사하고요. 특히나 그 질문도 많이 해주셔서 감사하고 또 그 무엇보다도 이렇게 발표 준비하시고 또 오늘 좋은 발표해 주신 또 세 분의 발표자와 그 다음에 또 좋은 토론해 주신 여섯 분의 토론자분들께 큰 박수로 큰 박수
Unfortunately, we are out of time, so now let us proceed to the award and certificate ceremony. So I have just received the results for the second place for our essay competition, and can I get a drum roll, please? The 2017 Next Generation Award for the challenger is Robert Eric Leinberger. Congratulations. The Korean Foundation Challenger Award is proudly bestowed upon you in honor of your achievement at the essay competition for the Next Generation Conference. And now for the grand award. Second drum roll, please. The 2017 Next Generation Award goes to Bohesa Won. Congratulations, the Korea Foundation Grand Award is proudly bestowed upon you in honor of your achievement at the essay competition for the Next Generation Conference. Now for the certificate ceremony. The 2017 Next Generation Conference Certificate of Recognition. Goes to Nikora Karamova. Presented to you in recognition of your dedicated participation at the essay competition for Next Generation Conference.